You're watching RISKSA TV. I'm Hannah Barry, and I'm coming to you from the International Insurance Conference Southern Africa 2013. With me is guest of honor and keynote speaker all the way from the States, Dan Glaser, who's the president and CEO of Marsh and McLennan Companies. Dan, firstly, welcome to South Africa.
Oh, thank you very much. It's great to be here.
The theme of your address at the conference this year is risk, resiliency, and return in a transforming industry landscape. What characterizes this industry landscape and world that insurers find themselves in?
Well, I like to call it that we live in a world of relentless acceleration. Everything's just coming at us faster than ever before. There's more dislocation, more change, more technology development. And so insurers and insurance brokers and really everybody in the risk business has to adapt to that. Now, it is one of those stories which is the best of times, the worst of times, just as Charles Dickens wrote so long ago, because, you know, you can get paralyzed with fear about all the speed of change. But on the other hand, you can use some of those same changes to help transform your company and your industry.
In this risk age, this risk society, where really the size and scope of risk is unprecedented, some people would argue that the private insurance industry is rendered hopelessly inadequate, that the nature of risk is such that more and more risks will become uninsurable. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, that's an interesting comment, and I'm not sure that risks are at an unprecedented level. I think that probably every generation, whether it was 25 years ago or 150 years ago, thought that the complexity and the scale of risk was unprecedented, you know? And so I do think that the awareness of risk is probably unprecedented. I mean, people talk about risk. Risk is a growth industry. And really, in a large part, CEOs have become chief risk officers. I mean, boards of directors and shareholders expect the CEO to know the greatest risks that are facing their organization and have plans as to how to deal with those risks. Now, when I think about the broad category of risks and how the insurance industry matches up, I first start with the whole concept of risk, that this is a risk business. Insurance is a small part of that business. But really, companies need advice around risk. They also need advice in transactions around insurance, but it's less important than them understanding their own risks and ways to either avoid, mitigate, keep, or transfer. There's profit in risk. I mean, risk and reward are very closely linked. Now, in terms of the pool of risks and whether the insurance industry is keeping up, I can name all kinds of products, everything from trade credit and political risk and cyber liability coverages and many, many more that are essentially growing into our new society. And so I'm quite certain that the risk will always be bigger than what's insurable, and so that non-insurable risk will always play a part for governments and companies and individuals to deal with. But I do think that the insurance industry is quite innovative and is coming up with other ways for companies and individuals to transfer their risks.
You mentioned that, you know, you really think insurers need to build resilience to risk, and we often hear the term risk management in our industry, that insurers need to manage risk, and they especially need to teach their clients how to manage risk. Why resilience rather than management?
I think they're both very important. Risk management is about largely identification and creating risk registers and talking about risks and trying to anticipate risks. And then developing plans and priorities as to which risks a company wants to keep, which risks that they can avoid, which risks that can be mitigated, and then which ones can be transferred via insurance or other mechanisms. And so risk management is vitally important. And I think the world has done very well at risk management. I mean, I've been in this business for 30 years, and I can tell you that the level of man-made losses and explosions at plants and safety in general is just much higher and taken much more seriously than it was 30 years ago. Longevity, people are living longer, the quality of life is higher. You know, with all that we hear to worry us about health, the reality is health systems around the world have greatly improved, and to a large part, all of that is about risk management and has been driven by risk management. The reason why we at Marsh McLennan talk a lot about risk resilience is because time and time again, we prove that we're good at dealing with known risks. And so things that have happened before, we tend to work really well with and create management systems to do, as I said before, avoid, mitigate, keep, or transfer. What we're not so good at is anticipating risks. Like I think about things like, why wasn't it anticipated? I mean, it doesn't seem that outlandish to think that, okay, there could be an earthquake off the coast of Japan, because Japan is in a seismic zone, and that earthquake could cause a tsunami, and that tsunami could cause damage to a nuclear facility which is located on the coast. Now everybody describes it in the nuclear industry as ETN. People will talk about their ETN risk, ETN, earthquake, tsunami, nuclear. But we didn't anticipate it. We didn't anticipate the volcanic ash cloud in Iceland that shut down traffic in Europe a couple of years ago. And so I think that risk resilience is recognizing that we are going to get hit with certain things that we can't anticipate, black swans. And so it's very important for us to have systems and methodologies to prepare for the unknown, and therefore that preparation, we don't have to prepare for individual risks. We can prepare for black swans, knowing that things can happen that we have to respond to and be resilient. We have to know, as companies and as families, how to take a punch.
Off the top of your head, if you could single out an unanticipated risk currently, or perhaps one of the most, what you think is an underemphasized risk, what would it be?
I don't want to make you afraid, but there are several risks that I would consider to be emerging risks that have significance to society. I'd start with cyber risk. Now, people don't talk much about cyber risk anymore. They're actually beginning to talk about cyber warfare. So this may be state-on-state type of risk exposures, and I think with the growth of technology, there's a huge amount of value creation that can occur, but there's also a huge amount of value destruction. So I'd put cyber risk close to the top. I would also talk about unfunded social liabilities. There's an awful lot of governments around the world who have made promises to their populations, and those populations are expecting some level of Social Security benefits, medical retiree benefits, 30 years from now. The right levels of money are not being put away. In fact, most of those retirement programs are run on a current account basis, where people who are working today are paying for retirees today. And we have a demographic time bomb, which will make it much more difficult to fund these social liabilities in the future. So those are two that come to mind very quickly.
South Africa and Africa is obviously in a slightly unique position in that we are exposed to these global risks and threats, but we're also in a situation where we're faced with immediate daily risks such as inequality, poverty, crime. If you could give a message to the financial services industry in this context, in South Africa and into the rest of Africa, what would be your message?
Well, I think I would probably focus more on the insurance industry than financial services, because banks and investment banks, they have their own issues to deal with. I think from an insurance industry perspective, we should be proud of our industry. I mean, if anything was learned in the financial crisis, is that the insurance industry actually performed quite well. It did not seize up. New business was pursued. New products were innovated. Claims were paid. Policies were issued. And so the industry, really behaved quite well. And so I would say, this is an industry that's about two things. It's about protection, but it's also about enablement. And so there is no investment without insurance. Nothing happens without insurance. And so the industry itself is at the absolute bedrock foundational level of improvements to society. And so I would say be proud of the industry you work for.